YouTube world, my name is Nicholas Montez, and you're watching my YouTube channel, The Teenage Movie Critic. And welcome back to the YouTube channel, everybody. I'm so excited to have y'all back together again. And in today's video, we're reviewing the most anticipated film of the year, Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1. If you're wondering why I'm filming on this side of the room, is because part of this side of the room is a little bit not, like, presentable at the moment. So you're going to see the window, plus some other cool posters, you know. That one, plus that one. So let's go ahead and get started reviewing Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning. So to talk about the film, because, you know, this is sort of in the category of how I feel about Spider-Verse, where I love Spider-Verse, but I'm not saying it's like a masterpiece of animation, superhero, Spider-Man film. I would say it's in a masterpiece in animation standards, story level, I don't know. Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1, I thought was a great, it was a great part one of two for the conclusion to this franchise. Sorry, that was inappropriate. But to talk about the film, let's just talk about it. So, I mean, you know, the first thing you gotta talk about here, to talk about the simple thing, I think the plot of this movie, it's like, this is the first part of a part one of two that's ending the franchise, and you're thinking, and what's crazy about these films is these are, though I believe these are the ones that are closing out, because we recently heard that Tom Cruise wants to make Mission Impossible films till he's in his 60s, like, till he's in his 80s, like Harrison Ford. But this is supposed to be the last two Mission Impossible films, at least that we know of. And I think the story that they came up with, this AI thing, and, you know, it is kind of reminiscent as to what is happening in the real world right now with the whole AI system thing, and that all actors and writers are going on strike. Seems a bit predictable, but I think for the story that... And then it also kind of brings in some secret invasion stuff, where that whole show is about not continuing stories, but it's finding out what's truly real. And I guess with that type of power and finding out what's truly real, it's the best power in the world if people want to get that. And so they have to get, so, you know, they have this MacGuffin in the movie where they have to find this key so that way they can unlock, so, and one person knows what it unlocks. And, you know, so they have to get this key, otherwise whatever it unlocks is probably going to be very bad. I'm guessing it unlocks the AI system entity. And I think throughout the whole story, it's a little bit more memorable because it ties into the stuff with Ethan, a little bit into his history, especially with the villain that is introduced. And it just sets up that thing that I love about Fallout, where he has to figure out, how am I going to save my friends, and how am I going to focus on the mission? Like, he has to push them aside and have them hide away, so otherwise they're going to be dead. And there's even sequences where, like, the AI copies Benji's voice when he's, like, trying to bring Ethan to his place to go find this person. It's like, it builds that tension of it. Speaking of which, let's talk about the other things. And, really, the new cast, let's just talk about the characters, and once again, I thought this was a nice tease for Ethan's backstory, where we get to learn more, a little bit about what his life was before the IMF, where we learn about this guy that killed his wife in another life, not in another time, but in another life, which I thought was, an interesting aspect to explore for history of characters. Of course, you know, it had some fun banter with Benji and, I keep forgetting the guy's name that always helps him. I forget. But to be clear, I think another thing that I loved about this movie, now we're on characters, is I really like the way. Because one of my things that I did not like about Fallout is they introduced some really good talent, but they didn't use them to their great effect. Like, in the Fallout, they introduced Angela Bassett and Vanessa Kirby, which are great people, and we know them great as actresses. We know Angela Bassett from Black Panther. We know Vanessa Kirby from Hobbs and Shaw. But if we want to go see those people, we're going to go to those films. No one is going to go to Vanessa... is going to go to Fallout to see them. However, I think in this movie, they did introduce some characters that I thought were memorable, and I actually did like, and they used them to perfection. Like, for example, you get introduced to Hayley Atwell's character, which there was something so fantastic about in the way they used her, in the way Christopher McQuarrie used her, as you could tell by a lot by her eyes, and the way her hands, and even with Vanessa Kirby's character, which I loved, and even in the dynamic that she has with Ethan throughout the movie is fantastic. And it also just kind of gave a different sense of vibe with this actress, with Hayley Atwell, where we don't really see her much in movies where we just know her mostly as Agent Carter in the MCU, but now we get to see her as Grace in Mission Impossible, and she is great, and I want to see her, and like most people, I want to see her in more stuff. And then, of course, you know, Vanessa Kirby's character, once again, both her and Hayley Atwell are just gorgeous in this film. It's like, like they need a boyfriend or something. Like, they are gorgeous. By the same time, Vanessa, I like the way that Vanessa Kirby's character was involved in the story a little bit more and was involved in the film a little bit more. And then, of course, you got Pom Klementieff's character, which I would say is probably the weakest of our new characters. But I would say that she's a nice addition that is a force to be reckoned with. She's very powerful. But at the same time, she like the fact that this one little thing... And even another great thing about the movie is that they use certain details, like... And it's so important to the film. Ethan sparing Paris's life means so much to the film that she's gonna die. And that turns her into a good guy. Which is so fantastic. And I love the way they did that. Plus, the little moments of certain characters caring for this person that is about to pass out of blood loss. That's fantastic. Like, I don't see many characters caring about other characters that are on the same, that are on the opposite side in movies. And that's fantastic. And we get that in this movie. And then even the other two guys where I'm like, these guys are just going to get defeated in the end. They're just going to get too lost. But as they continue, like... They start to have a moral compass in how they actually mean throughout the story. And maybe in Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 2, well, they're probably going to become part of IMF. Who knows? We'll just have to wait and see in a year or two. And then, of course, to talk about the last two things of this film that I thought were spectacular are, of course, the amazing action sequences and the score. Obviously, with the action... You know, when it comes to the Mission Impossible franchise, and of course, you know, Top Gun Maverick, Tom Cruise is a great filmmaker when it comes to amazing action. You look at all these other, like, superhero films, and they don't do action like this. Like, I haven't seen John Wick 4, but I'm not gonna lie, I have seen scenes of it. Like, the scenes of him fighting Scott Adkins, or him in the scene with the museum thing, that's awesome. And I did see Extraction 2, and that long hallway fight, or the gym fight, they're awesome. Chris Hemsworth's arm being on fire, that's awesome. But then you get in this movie, and first you get a car chase, which I thought was excellent, and just using car sounds, so it used a bit of music, and same thing with the train sequence, but it used car sounds as, like, the background, as the music. Not necessarily the music, but sort of as the sound in the scene to make it intense. And then you get into the motorcycle scene where he rides off the cliff and it goes straight silent, and then it goes straight back to sound, and it's like, you get scared for a minute because I'm like, oh shit, that scared me, and my heart is racing. And then the train sequence, once again, it uses music, but it also uses sound. And even in the way when the train is falling off the cliff, it feels like everything is floating, and like you're flying in the air, and you feel suspenseful through it, and it's just so great. And I love the way that those action scenes were put together, and those suspenseful thriller stuff of it was so great. And then, of course, to top it all off, the way that the music was used in the film, of course, the amazing score in the beginning of the film is fantastic. And then, of course, you also got the amazing score when Hayley Atwell and Tom Cruise are doing that little thing, where it felt kind of like classical music into an updated version of a film that I just thought that was so great. The scene in the airport when Benji is trying to deactivate the bomb, so great. There's so many great things I loved in this film. However, we do have a couple of issues, so let's talk about the bad. Now, there's not exactly many issues I have with this movie. I would say this is definitely another one of the great Mission Impossible films. I think when it comes to my problems with the movie, it sort of has to do with the cliffhanger. Because, you know, this is kind of the year for cliffhangers. And, you know, Fast X, where you get Dom and his kid at the bottom of the Grand Canyon with bombs surrounding them, along with Giselle, along with Letty, what's her name? Cypher meeting Giselle, and then Dwayne The Rock Johnson coming back. Get across the Spider-Verse. Miles is trapped in Earth 42, surrounded by his alternate self. And then Gwen makes a team. This film, I don't know necessarily if it, what the cliffhanger is. Like, they got the key, but then they say this is only the beginning of the entity. What exactly does that mean? Like, I'm excited for the next film, but I don't know exactly what's that going to lead to in the next movie. So that's kind of frustrating. Though I will say this: of all the movies that have cliffhangers, Fast X, Cross the Spider-Verse, Dead Reckoning Part 1, I would say this one definitely has the best conclusion to our story, and I'm excited for the next film. And to be clear, I'm excited for Fast 11, I'm excited for Beyond the Spider-Verse, and I'm excited for Dead Reckoning Part 1, but I thought this was the best way to conclude this story, better than Across the Spider-Verse and Fast X. And really, two other problems I have with the movie. I feel like this is probably the most mature Mission Impossible film, that there were some, like, with the AI plotline, it was kind of hard for me to understand a little bit. Like, of how, like, with Truth and AI system, it's like, I'm almost confused as to how AI works. Because I always think, oh, it just predicts your future. Oh, it just mimics your sound. I'm so confused as to what AI really is. Please, someone, explain me down in the comments. What is AI? You can say how much. You can say, bro, how do you not know what AI is? Bruh, I'm not an adult. I'm 16. I may be almost an adult, but I still have much to learn. I don't watch the news. I've heard about the writer strike and actor strike, but I don't watch all that stuff. But yeah. And then I guess probably some other things to talk about here. I feel like that there were some suspenseful scenes, and I just feel like they could have been set up to do cool action scenes, but they just were not used as much. And I feel like that was one of my strengths for Fallout, where you had people like looking at the characters, and then they would just go out into fight, but they didn't do it in this movie. And then, of course, I think in certain characters, they disappear, like, the black guy that helps them. I understand why he wasn't there, because he had to disappear, but we don't see him for the rest of the movie. Kind of disappointing that happened, but at the same time, I still thought it was great. Overall, this was another great film in the Mission Impossible franchise. I loved it. So that's my review for Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1. Before I get my final score, be sure to comment down below. What were your thoughts on this movie? Did you guys love it? Did you guys hate it? What are you between? Let me know all your thoughts down below in the comment section below. With that said, let's get all my scores. Alright, so that's it for my scores. Thank you guys so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. All my social media stuff is in the about section over there. And I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye-bye.